It's possible that the most completely amazing and exciting flying saucer tales are told by the charming Orfeo Angelucci. Mr. Angelucci claimed that his original sighting was even before the Kenneth Arnold affair. It took place back in 1946. But his first contact didn't happen until 1952. However, as unbelievable as all that was, nothing compares for pure wildness with this story of Orfeo Angelucci.
I entered the door, and at the table nearest the door was a very, very handsome man. And as I approached, he says, "Greetings, Orfeo. Sit down." And I said, "You have a third glass here. Is someone with you?" He looked at the glass, and he was surprised. He said, "I don't know how that happened, but I only ordered two glasses." He asked me to order. Then he asked me if I wanted a bottle of beer. I said, "No, not tonight." So he says, "Good." He lifted the pitcher of water from the table and poured it into my glass. Then he went into his pocket and he said, "Then how about some of the best champagne in the world?" He took out a little pellet and dropped it in my glass, and it started to fizzle like his own. So he told me to call him nothing but Adam. Two months ago, he had discovered he had 9 months to live. He had cancer, and it was incurable. Anyhow, he says, "Eat up. Let's dine and just get acquainted for the time being." I noticed that his glass was filling itself with water, but no one had poured it in there. So we went on for a while, and as the dessert approached, I heard music coming from the glass. It was subdued music. He said, "Wait a minute. On this pitcher here, the water was up to this black spot. Now it's down here." He said, "But the pellet." He went into his pocket and he says, "Wait, I'm supposed to have four." He took out the pellets and only three. He said what they were doing was sublimating the water, or evaporating it from the pitcher into the glass by remote control, and sublimated the pellet in his pocket over into the glass so that no one ever actually saw the process. Of course, I knew now that he had had either experience with space visitors or that he himself was one. And then I looked up at him and I noticed that he was looking now intently into the glass. He had a little smile on his face, yet tears were streaming down his eyes, landing right on the table before him. I thought, "God, what is it that he is going on?" I looked at the glass, and now there was the figure of a girl dancing in it with blonde hair, a little miniature woman, just dancing to the music, and the music itself became more spirited as she danced. I never saw such dancing before. Immediately I thought, well, Adam is either recalling someone or he's had an experience out of this world, literally out of this world. When she disappeared, she never looked at me. She always looked toward him. But in the finale, when the music ended with a crash, she suddenly whirled and went on her knee and looked toward me. But she had a very grim aspect on her face, as though to say, "You don't know now, but you soon will why and what Adam is experiencing now." And with that gesture, that is when she got down on her knee, bowed like in a curtsy, and a grim look toward me, as much as to tell me, "You too will know what Adam is now experiencing someday," she completely disappeared. That was the end of the dance, and the music ceased.
You know, that to me is the wildest and most beautiful of all the stories to arise from the flying saucer phenomenon. But what of the down-to-earth, rational evaluation of UFOs, that is, unidentified flying objects? Listen to one of the most famous and respected of news commentators in the history of radio, Mr. Frank Edwards.
"Why do I persist in regarding these so-called saucers as realities? Well, I do this because during the 12 years or so that I have been interested in these things, I've had reason to change my mind about them. At first, I thought they were some development of ours, and I'm sure there were a lot of other people in this country who thought that. But as the years went by and things happened, I realized, as did many other people, that these things, most of them, are nothing more than conventional objects seen under unusual circumstances and misconstrued by people who do not recognize them for what they are. But there is a small percentage of these things that simply cannot be explained away as conventional objects. And the Air Force certainly doesn't regard them as conventional objects because it has, upon occasion, issued orders to shoot them down. You don't shoot down hallucinations, and you don't shoot down atmospheric disturbances. You don't shoot down temperature inversions. These things have to be real and solid. Now, I belong to an organization called NICAP. The chairman of the board is Admiral Hillencutter. Our first one was Admiral Farney, the father of our guided missile and the man who coined the term guided missile. And he liked the rest of us on the board, and he said so publicly in his opening statement. He was convinced that these things came from somewhere in space and that they were entering our atmosphere and had been for quite a while, and that they were the work of intelligent beings and were certainly not subject to human control. And Admiral Farney said this, not exactly in those words, but that's as nearly as I can remember it. That was the gist of it. And now the chairman of the board is Admiral Hillencutter, the former head of Central Intelligence. Hillencutter was in a position to know what was going on. We also have on the board Colonel Forney, who headed one of the Air Force saucer research projects, who certainly was in a position to know what was known as far as our official research programs concerned. So many things have happened in this field that if you are close to it and have been able to get at some of the facts in it around the carefully laid censorship plans and the plan of deception and confusion that has existed and bad reporting too, you see that there is something substantial there, although we may not know what it is or where it comes from, and we certainly do not control it. In my opinion as a newsman, and in my judgment as a newsman of 36 years experience in broadcasting alone, I feel that this could be one of the biggest news stories of all time if we can get the facts out before the public and the reality of these things and their origin, as some of us suspect the origin to be, can be confirmed. I agree with Dr. Herman Oberth and with Admiral Farney and others that these things are probably interplanetary, and that I have no idea where they come from, but I am confident, in view of all the evidence that has piled up about them, that they certainly do not originate on the Earth, but where they come from and why, I don't know. These things have been photographed, and they have been seen, and they have been tracked by radar, and the government has issued a book on how to recognize them when you see them on a radar screen, how they performed when they came over the city of Washington in numbers on the night of July 19th and 20th, 1952, and about three nights later they were back again, and then on the night of August 13th, 1952, according to this government book which I have in my possession, there were 68 of them over Washington at one time, and the book was issued for the guidance of control tower men and other men how to recognize the things and how to know what you were seeing when you saw them. Now, to those who haven't seen them, let me say that these things are fully as real as cosmic rays. I've never seen one of them either, but I have seen the tracks that they've made when they were photographed. I've also seen the pictures of these things when they have been photographed. And so they are at least as real as cosmic rays, and for that reason, they constitute another thing that we know exists, but which we certainly do not fully understand.
Yet always, on the other hand, we have the really unbelievable claims of men like Dan Martin.
What happened in 1955, Dan Martin?
I guess it was midnight. I was driving along a rather remote section of Texas. Suddenly, I began to tingle. So I pulled off to the side of the road. Just as I came to a stop, an object came up from behind me and on the opposite side of the road. And it came to a stop, pulled just ahead of me. The back end of the thing was just about even with my radiator. Now, this thing had very much the appearance and was about the size of a diesel railroad locomotive, possibly 50 feet long. And I could see what appeared to me to be two men through glass or windows. But I walked up to within about 4 feet, I'd say. A door opened in the stern. A lady stepped out on the ground. Now, this lady weighed around 120 pounds, maybe. She was wearing a mask. It had glasses over the eyes. Then she hooked her thumbs under this thing, and she peeled it back over her head and held it in her hand. She looked at me and smiled. Now, I know that you're going to say, oh, she was a gorgeous beauty, but I didn't say that. But she was a very nice-looking girl. And she said, hello there, Mr. Martin. She didn't say hello thee, or she didn't use any Bible terms. She said, hello there, Mr. Martin. I said, hello, you. Then she told me that I would be contacted later and taken aboard a spaceship. And she told me that they were from the planet Mercury. I asked her why it was that she, being a lady, came out to talk to me when I could see that there were men aboard. Her reply was she was the only one aboard who could speak my language. Then I said to her, our scientists tell us that Mercury is so too close to the sun to afford or permit animal life, much less human life. At this, she smiled, and she said, well, you see me. Am I alive? Then she repeated that I would be contacted later, but she didn't say when, and that I would be taken aboard a spaceship. At that, the door opened exactly as it had before. The lady stepped back inside, and it took off. And in a matter of a couple of 2 or 3 seconds, it was out of sight.
Getting back to Sirius saucer research, the most important independent investigating agency in the world is NICAP. That is National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena. It is directed by retired major of the U.S. Marines, Donald E. Kehoe. This is Major Kehoe.
I wonder if you could tell us what the organization NICAP, National Investigations Committee on Aerial Phenomena, does. In other words, what is the interest of the organization? Why do people become members of it? And what is its purpose?
Well, Long John, the organization was created to try to get back of all the ridicule about flying saucers, to determine the facts, and to end the secrecy, which our group considered dangerous. It's composed of retired officers in all the services, airline captains, scientists, technicians, experts in various fields, besides members of most of the professions, and people in all 50 states and some 30 foreign countries. We analyze reports which are sent in to us by these members, also reports which are given us off the record by members of the military services. These things are evaluated by the scientists in our advisors panel and by our board of governors.
Major Kehoe, you said that NICAP was formed with a thought in mind to end the secrecy. Has the secrecy come to a halt?
No.
And what was the actual secrecy?
Well, the secrecy is based on Air Force Regulation 200-2, which prohibits all Air Force personnel from even mentioning these things with, quote, unauthorized persons, without permission from headquarters. There is also a federal law, the Espionage Act, which is invoked by the Joint Chiefs of Staff under J-146, which prevents anybody from revealing a UFO report that's made under that order. You'll find that in most cases, people in the government or even on the airlines who have made official reports are unable to reveal these.
Do you believe, Major, that there are such things as flying saucers?
There is one type of UFO which is actually a flying saucer shape. That is the disc. Now, the Air Force itself said this back in its Project Grudge report, which they said the majority of things reported to them described disc-shaped objects which had a diameter about 10 times that of their thickness, and mm-hmm. they were capable of high speeds, accelerations, and so forth, and completely superior to anything we had. Now, that is essentially a saucer-shaped device. But there's also the projectile-shaped device, which is the second one most commonly seen, and that's not a saucer. But most people talk about any unidentified object. So I have accepted the fact that there are saucer-shaped objects.
But they are unidentified at the present time.
As to the source, as to the purpose, and just about everything connected with them, even their propulsion. We speculate about it, but we do know, or we're convinced, that they're not from any nation on Earth.
You're implying, Major Kehoe, that evidently they are coming here from other planets.
That's right. Well, this is the conclusion of the majority of our Board of Governors and technical advisors.
And as a group, you feel that these UFOs or flying saucers are coming here or hovering over this planet, and they are coming here from other planets. Is that about it, sir?
That's correct. They've been seen, they've been pursued by jets, they've been photographed, triangulated by radar, mm-hmm. They've been paced over measured distances, they have outsped every jet that's gone after them, they engage in maneuvers that are completely impossible for anything mm-hmm. that we know. Incidentally, the Air Force itself came to this conclusion long ago in a top secret estimate, which they have been denying ever since it leaked out, but it was confirmed by their former project chief, Captain Ruppelt, and the existence of that document has been confirmed in a very careful statement by Major Fournet, who was the monitor on the project. Now, when he saw it, it was still top secret, so he can't say what was in it. But he says it did exist, and the Air Force statement that it didn't is untrue.
And that's about it. Oh, I don't mean that there's not a tremendous amount more. There are dozens of other sighters and contactees who could have told their stories, but obviously space doesn't permit. However, these were the top figures in the flying saucer UFO age. And whenever this time is remembered, these will be the men they talk about. These, and may I fondly hope, the man who originally introduced this incredible period to the American public. Yours truly, Long John Nebel.